Keys Bartender coming to you from Key Largo. It is, I think, June 23rd, Tuesday. We started this wild journey of the podcast about 3 years ago, a little over three years ago, 38 months, and we're still going. COVID-19 be damned. The name of this episode is It's Florida, Stupid. Now, you could say it three different ways. You could say It's Florida, Stupid, with apostrophe after Florida and then stupid. Or you could say It's Florida, Stupid, meaning that's pretty stupid. That's Florida, Stupid. Okay? But the answer to that is Florida, Stupid. Who's number one in new COVID-19 cases? It's Florida. And as the president would say, it's because it's one thing. It's because of all the fucking testing. If we didn't do all the testing, we wouldn't have all these cases. Matter of fact, if they stopped testing altogether, we wouldn't have any new cases, and we'd be zero cases. Zero cases right now without testing. According to that logic, that's all I can say there. And that's Florida stupid. And we are kicking and screaming. As some people say, Jim, how do you think this is all going to turn out? Well, we're going to get to the other side of this no matter what. This is going to be over eventually. And the best way, probably the best way, is to try to make it as less painful as possible. And a lot of experts have been saying for a long time to maintain smart strategies such as social distancing and wearing masks when in public. And people have built whole sciences around why masks are bad, why you shouldn't wear a mask, why it's going to be worse with a mask. But they stay away from that idea. It's like it's mainly for the other person and things like that. When people argue about the mask, it's more about them being uncomfortable, finding it hard to breathe, breathing in the same air. You know, if I had to breathe in your breath, I'd probably have a hard time with it too. I understand. But, you know, just think of it. The first time people were required to wear shoes, when shoes were developed, right? And then it was kind of like cell phones, right? Not everyone has shoes. Hundreds of years ago, or thousands of years ago, you know, they started putting pieces of leaf, making the fashion them into shoes, and then taking animal hides, stitching them together, making shoes, sandals, and things like that. And then after a while, once everyone got them, they required people to wear shoes. You know, eventually there was a time when there was probably a time where some people didn't wear shoes and some people wore shoes and some people were going to wear shoes. And I guess shoe wearing became a sign of your social status. You know, you don't have shoes, I have shoes, you know, and things like that. But at a certain time when everyone had shoes, they required shoes as they do shirts for people to come in to their establishments. And I'm sure there's a lot of places where people come from. Like down here in Florida, there's certain groups of people that don't like to put on shirts. And all you have to do is watch an old episode of Cops. You know, if you go to a trailer park, a lot of people in trailer parks, for some reason, don't like wearing shirts or shoes. And sometimes not even pants. Because a lot of that when they're chasing naked guys around and stuff like that. Just the way it is. But, you know, become accepted. Not everyone. There's no big movement out there to, you know, give you freedom not to wear a shirt. And you know what? It is inconvenient sometimes to wear a shirt. It's hot outside. Years ago, it's crazy. People talking about fucking masks, how uncomfortable they are, how inconvenient they are, how they mess up their makeup. Years ago, if you weren't a working man, if you were a businessman, regular businessman, shopkeeper, whatever, in the height, it's what, 90 degrees today in Key Largo, 80% humidity. 90% humidity. They used to wear linen suits with hats. And the women would wear dresses and stuff. Sometimes, you know, sleeveless became a thing eventually, but they'd be wearing dresses and hats and stuff like that. It was very, very uncomfortable. But that was what they did in polite society. And they did that for decorum. They wore those clothes for decorum's sake. Now it's a public health crisis, and you're arguing over it. It is not making people more sick. You're wearing a mask does not promote someone else getting sick. You can argue any way that, you know, it's hard for me to breathe. They have this problem. My God, if you can't breathe through a cloth mask, I don't know how you make it out there. And if you have a hard time breathing, maybe you should be concerned about this thing, because it's going to get you. And in the state, there's an 88% increase in cases. We're approaching 100,000 in Florida, if we're not passing that today. Monroe County reinstituted everyone wearing a mask. Eventually, they might require all public places, because Miami's, the municipalities in Dade County are starting to get the idea that perhaps people should be wearing them in public, and they're figuring out different ways of encouraging people to wear masks, because you can't. It's not working telling people something like, you know what, it's a considerate thing to do. You could be asymptomatic and not have it. And, you know, and everyone says, well, I don't want to listen to the show, Jim. I don't want to listen more about COVID-19 and stuff like that. Well, that's what we got to deal with as a bartender right now. It's not about a margarita or salt. We're not getting arguments with though how to make a margarita, how to make a rum runner, what's the best martini. We're getting arguments with people that come in, run up to a table and say, well, listen, I know I don't need a mask when I'm sitting and eating. Can I sit down and eat? And I make it a point right now. I hate to say it. If you're trying to do that tactic, I'm going to nip that in the butt and say you have to go to your car and get it. And then they'll leave and not come back. I understand that. And I understand we're losing business. But I'm standing on principle. You know, not. I don't worry about them breathing on me. I worry them breathing on other people. And if they're going to keep on trying to do that, you know, see if they can walk in with a group of people. If you have 8 people here in Florida, at this point in time, everyone knows the controversy about it. You better, in Monroe County, most places are enforcing it. I'm not one to call people out and stuff like that. But when you're enforcing it, you're enforcing good hygiene laws. You're trying to keep your people safe. I understand you want to make your political point. Well, you get together with your friends, get a bunch of flags and that are made in China, you know, and go on a boat and celebrate the birthday of President Bonespur. You know? Just, you can go and do that. There's your point. You don't have to make your point with your health when there's health repercussions. We get it. You die for the guy. He's a saint. He's brilliant. He's such a great businessman. Able to convert hundreds of million dollars in gambling assets into bankruptcies. You know, Trump University. All these things. You need to make a point. But don't do it with the mask. Do that. Go and get your mask. Go and get your Trump mask. Buy your Trump face mask. There you go. Buy your MAGA face mask on it. So I'm wearing it. I'm wearing it, but I'm supporting the president while I'm wearing it. I'm not one of those people that are wearing it just to protect people. I'm doing it to support the president. I have to. I have to wear the mask. I have to support the president. I'm not afraid, just like all the people that didn't go to the Tulsa rally. You know? Yeah. Some people may have reserved some tickets, but there was nobody in the overflow. There was just not that many people that could have showed up. They could have showed up at the outside. They just didn't come. There was no one there. And if they had been at the overflow, they would have invited them directly into the... I bet a bunch of the people that were inside there, supposedly there was a bunch of actors and stuff like that, to hire people to $150 a day to come in there. So that's how they get their rallies together nowadays. But I am done with that, but I will get on to a little conspiracy theories coming up, because I've been finding that conspiracy theories may be the way to go for a career direction for me, because they're very easy. But before I do that, I want to thank some of our regulars, like Ralph and Eva of Moorestown, Indiana. They're the owners of Ralph and Eva's Public House, a nice bar and restaurant in Moorestown, Indiana. And also, very good listeners here, Carol and Charles. Carol and Charles, they're from Milwaukee. And their bar is the Foundation Bar in Milwaukee. And it's a very cool place. Both of them are very cool places. In Milwaukee, this is a tiki bar. You'll find drinks like, certain rum punches and a blue Hawaiian and all these tiki drinks that you might expect to find here. It's funny, they do have those places down here, a couple places like that, but why even try to become a tiki bar after you see Charles and Carol's place, because that is the quintessential tiki bar. There's no place down here that I've seen that's like it. Tiki bars seem to really thrive in places that are untiki-like, like Milwaukee. But if you go there, it looks like you'd be transported. Now, someday I'd like to make my way there and do a podcast from there. And also from Ralph and Aiden's Public House, which looks like a really cool old-school tavern. And someday I will. Well, there was another couple I wanted to say hello to. It's Simi and Alex. They're from Bacal, from Miami. And they came in last night to the bar. And they were present. I don't think they were present for it, but there was another couple that was present. But they heard a lot of things I had to say to the people, Alex and Simi. Very nice looking couple. Hopefully they'll enjoy the show. I told them, it's not always home runs here with the podcast, but we try as we may. But there's another couple, and they're known in the neighborhood. They're known in Key Largo, so I'm not going to mention their names. And if you live in the town, you'll know who they are. But they're not shy about making their views known. So the people that know who they are, it's no news to them. The people that don't know who they are still don't know who they are, but they're going to know what they talk about. And they're a white couple. They're not married. She's in her 60s. He's in her 70s. She may be in her early 60s. Maybe late 50s. I see. Hope she doesn't hear this. Maybe late 50s. Let's say late 50s. He's just turned 70. He is a follower of a religion that was founded in Jamaica. And it's really big among listeners or purveyors of reggae music. And he trusts no politicians, and he insists he has not voted in 30 years. And he has a particular aversion for the Clintons. Yes, he just hates them, detests them. He has a real, like, a personal hatred for the Clintons, as if he was slighted by Bill, or Bill slept with a girl he or Hillary rejected him. I don't know. But he's very interesting. He suggests that he's non-political, but he seems to have reserved most of his hatred for more progressive and liberal politicians. And his girlfriend, I can say her name, she's kind of a pseudo-progressive, and her views are very liberal and kind of unusual. I didn't even have to say it's just unusual. And they can go on and talk to each other for hours. They're not really listening to each other. She'll go and throw out some trope that has to do with some progressive or liberal issue, and Jimmy will come out and say something kind of outrageous. And he does sometimes. I guess he hides behind the protection of age to say some things. We were watching NASCAR, and he, this is where all things started. And there was another couple, and I had no idea where they're from, but they were laughing when they heard them. And so Jimmy, oh God, so me, referring to myself, this other couple comes in, the one that has the political discussions, they sit down, and I have, and he asked for me to put NASCAR on. And I said, I have NASCAR on, I was watching it, it was in commercial. And he goes, you know, there's no reason why you can't put on NASCAR. And I said, well, I said, I did put on NASCAR, there's, if you could just wait a moment, it'll be back on. And then all of a sudden there was a symbol that said for, supported by NASCAR or something like that. And he wasn't paying attention. So he started complaining. He goes, well, I can watch Cornhole Championship or whatever it is you're watching. What is it? It's soccer. I see you have soccer on over there. And I said to him, you notice soccer on's over here, and over here it's in commercial, so I'm not watching that station that's over there on this other television. He goes, oh, yeah. So finally, they come back to the race. And he goes, oh, okay. And I said, okay. And then he gets into his thing. So Patty says something, and he starts yelling and stuff like that. And then he says, the checkered flag was originally used by the Masons, and they were blah, 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 blah. And I know where it's going to go and stuff like that. He'll start talking about his religious beliefs and all that stuff, and how all people are liars, and all these different groups he's usually saying the progressive groups are really hateful and all that stuff. But he doesn't really save any of this stuff for any reactionary groups, like white supremacists and things like that. But that's not what it is. So after he mentioned the Masons and went into his thing, I said, oh yeah, and the Rothschilds. And he looked at me, he goes, you got that right. They're involved in it. So I mentioned that. I mentioned the Queen of England. I didn't get around, because I stole that completely from So I Married an Axe Murderer. It's a Mike Myers film. And his father mentioned it. Pentaveret, which was the Rothschilds, the Rockefellers, the Queen, I forget, maybe Colonel Sanders before he went tits up, and maybe the Pope. I don't know. He called it the Pentaveret. I wanted to say the Pentaveret. Jimmy cut me off. And so he says something about space. Now, Jimmy is a flat earther. He's one of those people I talk about that believes that the earth is flat. And he mentioned space. And I said, it's not real. Space. He goes, what's not real? Space isn't real. It's just a projection. And I didn't say by who and stuff like that. And he says, hey, I think you're getting it. Like this. He thinks, well, he's considering. I'm going, wow, this is really easy. And then I go, and the Lindbergh baby didn't die. He's alive and well. And it's Woody Allen. That's his name today, Woody Allen. And he's looking at me, and he's not thinking. And then I said, and World War I didn't happen. That is why World War II is really World War I. And the next war we have that's big will be World War III, or World War II. I got all confused there, because you got to be careful when you're creating conspiracy theories. So he's looking at me again. He goes, my uncle fought in World War I. He was a Marine. And I'm going like, oh, well, there you go. Convenient. You have something you believe in. And then I said to him, can I talk to him? You know, knowing full well he would be 118 years old if he was a young soldier. 120, 100, I guess, wait. He'd have to be 120 years old. That fought a little bit in World War I. Around 120. So, and then, no, and it, it's not a given that it wasn't. But after that, I just thought, wow, how long can conspiracy theories go? Would it come out? Like, it's just it's just a gimmick. People have these shows and they go on to whatever news source and whatever you need to debunk. Like nowadays, we thought with the advent of the internet, everyone had internet, they had information at their fingertips, and everyone would be smarter for it. Now let that sink in. Everyone would be smarter for it, because even the most far-flung places, if they had internet connection, could have access to the world's information, the best information there are. There are master classes, they call them, or Harvard, free Harvard classes online. All these things that can make you a smarter person. But conspiracy theories have unique composition. First of all, let me give you the worst. You can take a very complex idea with conspiracy theories and make it surmisable. Be able to wrap your whole head around the idea that the reason why you don't have to think about water not staying in place if the earth is round. If the world's round, how come the water's not just pouring away from us? You know? Isn't there just going to one side? They don't up and down and all that stuff. They don't understand that up and down is a function of gravity, away from gravity wells. Meaning, all force goes towards the center on masses of planets. But the flat earthers, let's say the flat earth itself, just gave you the same thing. It's just the earth is flat. It makes perfect sense. That's it. That's the reason it all works. The earth is flat. But they don't talk about gravity either. Like gravity is just a token force. It's not generated by any the universe's forces. There's four strong forces. One's gravity. The other's electromagnetic. One's strong atomic nuclear force, and one's weak nuclear force. And I think it's four main forces in the universe. And try to explain that to someone. There's some people that need to have their stories tied up tightly, neatly. God created the world in a week, and then he rested on the seventh day, 6 days, rested on the seventh day. Very understandable to them. Poof. Just created. Each day he did it. It's no problem. Where did God come from? He always existed. Always was, always will be. No one created. There was no beginning or no end. It's somewhat difficult for scientists to explain the beginning of time, but they have, it's much more complex. So, what conspiracy theorists, when they come up with their alternate reasons for things to occur, like 9/11 didn't happen. The Israelis did it. The U.S. government did it. Newtown, the most heinous of conspiracy theories. That's with the children. They were all actors. No one died, and this didn't happen. So that was fake, but not all the other mass shootings were fake. They just made, it's a red. I think they call it a red flag event. But what conspiracies you believe in pretty much tell you what your bent is. I mean, there's conspiracy theories from the right and the left. And there's the ones that, if you look at the motivations that people have and stuff like that, who are the people in power? What motivations do they have to have it? Does it make sense? It's not always correct. Sometimes they may be interested in a certain outcome, but they didn't necessarily come up with the plan for it. So, COVID-19, as a means of the government getting control of you, it's a worldwide event. Unless you bring it out to the United Nations trying to do it. I mean, to say the U.S. government, or say Democrats are using it, or created it, or, yes, it could have been, it certainly could have been, and most likely is carelessness of China not to be able to alert people and raise the red flag right away to say that, hey, we have something going on here. Please be on the lookout. We're addressing it as quickly as possible. Whether it was in their lab that got out or whether it was one in their wet markets, it really doesn't matter, but we have the opportunity. And here we are back at COVID-19, but I didn't mean to do it. But the great conspiracy theories of it, there's the one, the multiple shooters for Kennedy. There is the moon landing. Whew. That was good. I had someone in the same political bent as me, and he did not believe in the moon landing. And I tried to explain that the confirmation for the moon landing was given by our enemies at the time, which was the Soviet Union and Red China, that we, they admitted that we did make that achievement of landing a man and returning him from the moon. So why would they do it if they had everything to gain to deny? But they pretty much have to say they could. They view the conspiracy theories just as crazy as the rest of us. They're saying they're not even trying to feed it. They could have fed it, but they didn't feed it. You know? It's just like when you hear those crazy things, and think of a conspiracy theory. I'll treat it as the guy, one of the shows, one of the daytime, Maury Povich show, or Sally Jesse Raphael. What is the new shows now? I don't know, but it's when you have a woman having a paternity test done to find the father of a child she has, and she'll sit there and she'll say, I know it was so-and-so. He was the only one that I had sex with. And she'll have done it twice before and said that. And they'll do the test and say, nope, it wasn't the one. It wasn't the one. At that point, I think that crosses a conspiracy or not. You know, them knowing that there's going to be a paternity test, knowing that it's probably not going to be that guy, or there's a 1 in 15 or 20 chance that it's that one particular guy, and acting like they're certain. I think they're certain when they bring people on, because it makes really great television, that the person isn't their father, the father of the child, and that it's just great television for her to start crying and acting like she is accursed by science. But it's great. It's such a great idea to do. Alex Jones does it. Come up with his theories. And they're all on the left, too. I would be on the left with that. But I just have a hard time not giving the facts. I don't like to get my source, my information from one source. I think it through. There are certain people, friends of mine, listen to one network, but they don't listen to certain people on that network because they say those people are troublemakers, or they're gadflies, or whatever that is, the people that go by facts. So, a conspiracy is a conspiracy, and you can just set it up. You just set it up, and a conspiracy is like gossip. You know, if you don't know exactly what went on, if you, so-and-so looks like she's putting on a little weight, maybe she's pregnant. Right? No. Maybe you should just go up to him and say, hey, listen, how you doing? Boom. Got anything to tell us? Nope. Okay. No confirmation there. Don't know if she's pregnant or not. It's easy enough. And if they don't say it, eventually when they give the kid, you know, if they're one of those people that, you know, go to the bathroom one day and all of a sudden, you know, plop. Oh, I was pregnant. Well, then what's the worst thing that happened? You didn't have to have a baby shower, you know? And they're going to have an interesting story to tell their children. Say, oh yeah, my mom didn't even know she had me until she gave birth. Really? Yeah. It happens every so often. Yeah. Especially here in Florida. Florida's big for that. And hopefully we're not going to be leading the country in cases for much longer. I would really appreciate if they didn't. I don't want to be known for that. And I do believe this is going to be over. And someday, we will or we won't be wearing masks in the future. Maybe it'll be things that will be strongly urged, just like they, you know, we wondered why when you looked over at Japan and China that so many people were wearing masks. Now we might know that whenever flu starts flaring up in China, where it's, you know, very densely populated, they're three times, they're about the size of the United States, and they have more than three times the population. So, yeah, they got a bunch of cities. They got multitudes of cities, over a million people. And as soon as there's a flu outbreak and stuff like that, maybe they all mask up. And what's wrong with that? You know? Some of these things, we don't know. We just don't know. We're not epidemiologists. So, do things that are least painful. The most painful thing is being on a ventilator, I expect. And losing a loved one. What you do, the less painful thing, is staying 6 feet around people you don't live with. You know, don't shake hands. And if you accidentally do shake hands, go and wash your hands right away. It's not an insult to that person. And suggest to that person maybe they should wash their hands too. I tell people after that. I said, I don't know. I don't know. It could be one of those people that have no symptoms. That's called asymptomatic. It doesn't mean you're asymptomatic just because you don't show any symptoms. You have to have, I believe you have to have it to be asymptomatic. Because everyone's asymptomatic until they're sick. So, if you use that measure, my measure is you're infected, but you're not showing any of the symptoms. And that's the thing you're most worried about. So forget about the conspiracy theories and stuff. Just think about being kind to people that you don't want to get sick. And if you're mean-spirited and you don't give a fuck and you're selfish, just tell these people that you're mean-spirited, you don't give a fuck about people. And that's the way it is. I don't want to wear a mask. It's inconvenient to me. Right? Oh, I don't want to mess up my makeup. I've spent a lot of time on my makeup and I want people to see me. I don't want to wear a mask. Fuck it. Wear the fucking mask, and you don't have to smile about it. You don't have to like it. Maybe you shouldn't be so pissed off about it. If you weren't so pissed off about it, maybe you'd eventually get used to it. It's no big deal, you know? So, this is Jim the Keys Bartender. I'll be trying to do a live show tomorrow with Papa Joe. Maybe do two live shows. I'd like to thank everyone for listening. I'd like to thank whoever my listeners in L.A. are. Appreciate that. And Washington, Virginia. And Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And Moorestown, Indiana. Boston, Massachusetts. Philadelphia. Are you hearing me, Philadelphia? Let's see. So, thank you very much. Have a great day. And I'll talk to you tomorrow. Bye. Oh, and before you get, follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And subscribe. Bye.